Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome, Facebook crowd. If you're with us this morning or whenever you join us, welcome, everybody, to our church service. Let's stand. Tim's going to lead us in responsive reading and opening prayer.
Good morning, everybody. Responsive reading. I love thee, O Lord, my strength.
I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies.
I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications.
Love the Lord, all you saints.
What do I
see?
Let us pray. O Heavenly Father, open our minds and hearts today to your word as we are taught today. This we pray in your wonderful, precious name. Amen. Amen.
Showers of blessings. Come on down, kids. We'll get you going here. Here they come. All right. Ouch. There's my favorite guy right there. Hi. Hey. Hey. There he is. Okay. I got to know something. Who's responsible for giving me this shirt? Was it you? Awesome. I want to say thank you. That's a wonderful shirt. Thank you, sweetheart. That made my day and week and, yeah, saved me from doing laundry and the whole thing. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, that's okay. Hey, children's story. Hi, how are you? What's your name?
My name is Charlie.
Your name is what?
My name is Charlie.
Hi, Charlie. How are you? Good. I don't remember all of your names. Hi, Joe. Hi, Joe.
His name is Peter.
No, his name is Joe. Peter. Joe.
Peter.
Okay, I know. I'm teasing you. Okay. Let's just talk about something this morning. How many of you have pets? Like a cat, a dog, a cow?
A giant dog.
Okay. Now I want you to think about something. Do you like your pet or do you love your pet?
A little bit of both.
A little bit of both. Okay. Since I'm right here, why do you like or love your giant dog?
Because she's giant.
Because she's giant. Okay. And I'll bet you because she likes you or he likes you. Okay.
Or he likes me.
Okay. Who else had a cow, a dog, a cat? Okay. Why do you like your, what do you have?
You have a dog and a cat.
Why do you like or why do you love your dog or cat? Tough question, isn't it? Okay, do you have an answer? Why do you like or love your dog or cat? Because they're always there. How about that? Okay, do you have a dog or a cat? I'll bet you have the same one, right? Okay, why do you like your dog or cat?
I don't like them.
You don't like them, okay. Take note, parents. All right. You start back to school tomorrow, right?
No.
Oh, you don't?
You just started
a spring break. Okay. So, well, since you're on spring break, how many of you have a teacher at school? All right, this is a tough question. Who wants to answer it? Why do you like your teacher at school? Why do you love your teacher at school? Come on. Okay, because
she's nice to me.
She's she's nice to you. She's mean to other kids, but she's nice to you. You're likable. You really are. All right, who has a teacher, and why do you love or like your teacher?
Because she's my mom.
Play it safe, I say. Play it safe. That's a good one. All right, who else has a teacher that you like or love? Okay.
Why do you like or love your teacher?
Because she do her best things.
She does best things, yes, yes. Okay, now we're going to go up one level higher. Your mom or your dad? Okay, why do you like or love your mom or dad? Who's got an answer?
Because they take care of us.
That's a good one, because they take care of you.
Because he plays football with me and likes me over Michael.
He likes you over what?
Michael.
Who's Michael? Well, I don't know about that, but he does play football with you. Okay, go ahead, Michael. You're Michael.
Because he lives with my grandparents.
All right. All right. Okay, you two. Why do you love or like your mom or dad?
Because they take care of us.
That's a good... That's his answer, but well, that's a good answer. Do you have a different answer? No? Just because they take care of you. How about this? Because they love you. And that's one thing that they do is they take care of you. Because now let's go one level higher, and then we're done. We're going to talk about Jesus. Why do you like or love Jesus? Go ahead.
Because he died for us.
It's a great answer, because he died for us. And what did he do in his death? Forgave our sins.
Forgave our sins.
Yeah, good answer. Awesome. Why do you like or love Jesus? You ever thought about that?
Because he's plain awesome.
Because he's plain awesome. That's a great answer. Why do you like or love Jesus?
Same as Michael.
Same as Michael. He died for us for our sins. Do you have an answer why you love or like Jesus, but you love him? Hey, Charlie, do you have an answer like why do you love or like Jesus?
Because Jesus loved me very much.
You can't beat that one for an answer. That's awesome, because he loves us very much. Okay, so let's just remember where I took you from your dog or your cat, and we used the word like or love. Then you went to your teacher. Then you went to mom or dad. And then we went to who? Jesus. He deserves our love because he loves us. All right, who would like to pray? Maybe I have a surprise for you guys, too. I've got some candy I've got to unload, right? I've got something over there I got to unload. So, Preston, would you like to pray? Fine. You want to pray, right? All right.
Dear God, I pray for the people that are in Ukraine right now, and that they can stay safe and find shelter and food. Amen.
Amen. Great job. All right. We'll see what we got over here, gang. Uh-oh. I got all kinds of stuff I got to get rid of. Okay, can I give a couple of these to your family, and you guys can share those later? You just give those to mom or dad, okay? Are you connected here? You're by yourself? Okay, do you guys want one of those? Okay. All right. Let's see how many I got here. Let's give these kids a round of applause here. There you go. There's another one. Yeah. Would you like that? I wanted to give that. You get two of them. How about that? You want another one? All right. You know what to do with. All right. You can go back and sit with your parents. You want one? There you go. Awesome. Before we continue in our worship, I just want to have a time of prayer. This afternoon, several of us are going to have a memorial service at the Crisis Center for Clark Iron. When we went down to serve last Sunday, some of the residents came to us and they were kind of traumatized because Clark had just died somewhere on 27th, and they watched him pass away right there on the bench as the ambulance came and tried to revive him. They were very traumatized. His service was at Crow Agency yesterday, and they came to the crisis center. And so we're going to have a memorial service for his street family this afternoon at 4:30. Linda and I, and maybe others, you can join us. It's going to be at 4:30 today. For Clark Iron, he was from Crow Agency, and he lived on the streets here. But we want to lift up his family and that service. Ken Lane had an interesting week this week. Interesting week. Wow. Very delicate, very complex surgery. He either went home yesterday as I saw him, or he's going home today. It was just a remarkable surgery. And so we want to continue to pray for him. Marcy Seitz is doing good, recuperating at home. All of these people could deserve a phone call from some of you or a visit. You can visit Bill Clagg at Bella Terra. He's kind of doing therapy. And, you know, this week, he's going to be 80 years old. And so you might want to call him and wish him a happy birthday. But those three I can think of right now that could use a visit, a call. Bill told me to tell everybody thank you for the prayers and the cards and the visits. Ken wanted me to share with people thank you for prayers. Very interesting week for him. And so there's a lot of people that you can reach out and touch and be in prayer for this week. But while we're just in a spirit of prayer, let's, before we continue our worship, let's pray. Father God, we thank you for touching our lives with your love. We thank you for the blessings, not just material blessings of health and financial resources, but we thank you. We thank you for touching our soul, for healing our bodies, for healing our minds. We thank you for your love, Jesus, that as we come together, that we can express our love to you in so many different ways. But this isn't the only place and time that we express our love to you. That's every day. Teach us how to do that, Lord. Thank you for every person that is here. Maybe for some, it's the first time that they've been here in our church service. Touch them. For some that have come now for several Sundays or whatever, just touch them. Lord, touch everybody here, Lord, even those that are online watching us either right now or sometime this week. Touch them. Father, we do lift up Bill to you and Marcy and Ken Lane. You just touch them, God, in a powerful way. Heal their bodies. Give them new strength. Give them new hope. Father, I think of Bob here. I just lift him to you. In their transitions of life, would you just give them great peace? Everything would fall together. I lift, Father, just as he manages in life, that you would just give great healing and strength to him. Father, I lift up Luella to you, that you would just touch her in a powerful way. Just minister, Lord, to her in a powerful way. Touch her, strengthen her, bring healing. Father, my purpose isn't just to stand here and pray for everybody that comes to my mind, because everybody needs a touch from you. Thank you, as I had people stand last week who had difficulty walking, that you would strengthen legs, that you would strengthen our spirit, that you would strengthen where places are weak in life, where there's a need for jobs, where there's a need for open doors, where there's a need for forgiveness, where there's a need, Father, just to walk in faith and trust you in the days ahead. And lest I forget, Lord, we lift up our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine, and we lift up our brothers and sisters in Russia who are praying daily. And as somebody reminded me this morning of how our brothers and sisters in Ukraine are getting out of bomb shelters. We struggle enough to get out of bed. to get into our cars to even come to church. But our brothers and sisters in many places in Ukraine are getting out of bomb shelters so they can go to a place of worship and praise your name as if nothing else is going on in their life. Forgive us for our apathy, for our complacency. Thank you for the joy that it is to come to a place and worship you. But we lift up our brothers and sisters. We thank you for the offering that we have given to our agency to provide relief. We thank you for the millions of dollars that is going to provide relief for people, refugees who need food and clothing and blankets and shelter. And our prayers make a difference this morning. So, Father, we do lift up our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine this morning, the church in Ukraine, that you would just touch them and bless them, protect all people in that great country. We ask as we continue in worship, Lord, we do so because we love you. May our worship, our hearts, our minds be in praise. In your name, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Lord, that we can join the ever-singing chorus around the throne, singing, worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb, worthy to receive glory and honor and power and praise. Thank you, Lord, that we can step into that stream anytime we turn our face toward you. And as we look at you, Father, thank you that our face is changed. And that as we gaze upon you, we become more like you. We look more like you. So that we can carry the goodness of your love around us. And they can see you in us. So we thank you today, Jesus, that you are the worthy Lamb who is coming back as a lion to set the rest of things right. Thank you that you've paid for sin and death and poverty and sickness and disease, and that death is the last thing to be conquered. We bless you today, Jesus of the resurrection. Amen. You may be seated, and the children can go to Sunday school.
No, that's not. Something's on. All right. Thank you, Pam. Appreciate that. I'm in a series on love, and we're going to talk about loving the Lord this morning. Turn with me to Luke chapter 7, verses 36 through 50. You might be there already. I just want to say thank you for giving to this Ukraine offering. You can see the total amount in the bulletin. Thank you for that. That's awesome. Did a great job. I have to say, I wasn't expecting that amount. I was just maybe a few hundred, maybe coffee change, something. Thank you for giving to that. Thank you for giving out of your joy to our regular offering in the back. Thank you. It's all appreciated. Luke chapter 7. Talk about loving the Lord this morning, beginning at verse 36. One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at table. And behold, a woman of the city, who was a sinner, when she learned that he was at table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment, and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who invited him saw it, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." And Jesus answering said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." And he answered, "What is it, teacher?" "A certain creditor had two debtors, one who owed 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they could not pay, he forgave them both. Now, which one of them would love him more?" Simon said, "The one, I suppose, to whom he forgave more." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning toward the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house, and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much, for he who is forgiven little loves little." And he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Then those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." What an incredible story. And I'm going to take a deep dive into this story. And I'm going to talk and walk you through this particular story. I know I've just read it. I don't want to insult your intelligence like, "Well, I just read it." But I'm going to walk through it again and kind of amplify some different points. We start at verse 36, where we see that Simon has invited Jesus to dinner. "I want to have a conversation with Jesus." There were other people who were dining, and although I'm going to skip ahead here, homes in that day were not so much like our homes today. Homes in that day were sort of like our back patio. They were open-air homes. So this woman, we can open up, and I've got it in three scenes here. You can easily kind of parse this story out with three scenes. The first scene is the woman crashes this dinner party, verses 37 and 38. On purpose, she learns that Jesus has been invited to a meal in this open-air, probably, house. So she goes on purpose. She becomes kind of the nuisance. That becomes a teachable moment about loving Jesus. A few things about this woman. She's never named in this story. She never says anything in this story. But she's the leader in this story. Albeit Jesus was the leader, but she's the one who's leading by example. Some have speculated that this woman was Mary Magdalene, who later followed Jesus. But we don't know that for sure. She's never named in the text. That's only been speculation throughout church history. She crashes this dinner party. And it may have looked something like this. We read in verse 37, standing behind Jesus, she kneels at his feet. You got to understand something. People did not sit at a table like we sit at a table. Much like at the Last Supper, Jesus was reclining and his feet were probably extended like that picture. So this woman crashes and is drawn to Jesus. I want to say something about that for just a moment. She's drawn to Jesus. This is kind of an awkward moment. She's identified as a sinner. That's Luke's polite way of saying She's a prostitute. And so this prostitute walks in and finds herself at the feet of Jesus. And then according to one scholar, she's drawn, I believe, theologically and spiritually, she's drawn to, and I don't understand this, she's drawn to the love of Jesus that she felt. I believe the Holy Spirit was drawing her to the Savior. Much like anybody else in the Gospels, when they wanted healing, when they wanted something from Jesus, they were drawn to him by his love. I don't want to suggest that Jesus had an aura about him. He had the Holy Spirit on him and in him and filling him. So I believe that when people were around Jesus, do you agree with this? They felt his love. She was drawn to that. She's not just crashing the party because she's trying to draw attention to herself. She's drawn mysteriously because she knows she needs forgiveness. And she's drawn mysteriously because of God's love is drawing her to the feet of Jesus. Then, according to one scholar, she lets her emotions get the best of her. Oh, doggone it. Imagine that. She allows her emotions. She starts weeping. Weeping. I wonder if her weeping was heard throughout that room. Sobbing. Her tears are falling on Jesus' feet. And then she takes her hair, probably like this picture, she takes her hair and begins to wipe his feet with her hair. It was considered inappropriate for a woman of the day to wear her hair unbound in public. Here she is having unbound hair, which was another signal, perhaps, that she was a prostitute. So she wipes Jesus' feet with her hair. And then she does another kind of a weird thing to our perspective. She begins to kiss his feet. That wasn't really a sensual act in that day. According to extra-biblical literature, rabbis often had their feet kissed by students as a way of showing honor and respect. So when we read this, we're going, ooh, that looks weird, that looks creepy, that looks awkward. In that day, that was considered a sign of respect and honor to kiss a rabbi's feet. And then she takes this ointment, a very expensive perhaps a vase of ointment, and she begins to anoint his feet. Well, that's scene number one. And I just want to stop here and say, at this particular point, Jesus is very secure. Jesus is not going, ooh, this is weird. What are you doing here? Stop that. It's like Jesus doesn't have any boundaries, as it were. He's allowing this woman to demonstrate her spiritual love, her adoration, her honor, her respect in her particular actions, her weeping, and her emotions. It's kind of like these two elderly gentlemen were praying. One was very quiet in prayer. The other one was shouting to God in prayer. The one who was quiet said, "You don't need to shout to God. He ain't deaf." The one who was shouting said, "You're right, he ain't nervous either." Jesus wasn't nervous. Can you imagine a scene like this happening at church? Can you imagine a scene, even a foot washing service? How many of you have ever been to a foot? This wasn't even a foot washing service yet. It was this woman demonstrating her love, adoration, respect, in a very emotional, emotive, weeping way. It must have been very powerful. Well, that's scene number one. Let's go to scene number two. Scene number two is this conversation between Simon and Jesus. And it picks up in verse 39, where Simon, this learned Pharisee, not all Pharisees were bad, this learned Pharisee, Simon, who had some spiritual interest because he wanted to talk with Jesus, invited him to dinner. That's a good step right there. He invites Jesus, and then he begins to say, and the text says he says to himself, was he just thinking this? Was that Luke's way of saying he's just thinking it? Was he kind of going, well, if Jesus really knew what sort of woman, was he just talking, muttering under his breath? But he says this, he thinks this, if you are really a prophet, you would have known what sort of woman this is, and you're not calling her on it, and you don't even have any integrity. Jesus, verse 40 says, I heard that, Simon. I heard that. And I've got something to say to you. This is where it's going to become a teachable moment. This scene number two must have gotten really intense. See, just reading it, you kind of don't get it, I don't think. You kind of have to kind of walk through it and think about it and what was going on here. So Jesus says to Simon, I've got something to say to you. I'm going to tell you a story, Simon. So he tells him this little pithy little parable about a creditor who's got two debtors, one who owed him a lot of money and one who doesn't owe very much. And he forgives them both. And he says to Simon, which one is going to love the creditor more, the one who's been forgiven a lot or forgiven a little? And Simon, being the good intellectual he was, he said, I think the one who is forgiven much. You have named it right, Simon. So Simon, I've got something to say to you. This is a great thing. When Jesus says, I've got something to say to you. Uh-oh. He's not going to say some things now to humiliate Simon. I believe he's saying these things. Now, here's why I want you to listen very closely, because I'm going to relate this to our life in a moment. He's not trying to humiliate him. He's not trying to put him in a corner. He's trying to get him to think through some things. And so he says to Simon, turning to the woman, he said, Simon, when I came into your house, you gave me no water for my feet. Which would have been a very good cultural greeting, just like Jesus at the Last Supper. Remember when he put on the apron? Because most households would have some sort of a servant or slave who would wash the feet of people walking into the house. Jesus said, you gave me no, you didn't even provide a wash basin for me to wash my own feet. But this woman has washed my feet with her tears. I wonder what Simon is feeling like right now. Well, let's continue the discussion, Simon. You gave me no kiss of greeting at all, which would have been a cultural nice thing. Not even a handshake, not even a hug, not even a kiss on my cheek to say, welcome to my house. You gave me nothing, Simon. But she has not ceased to kiss my feet in honor and respect. Well, it gets a little bit better than that. Simon, you never anointed my feet, but she has taken something very sacrificial, something very expensive to her, and she is continually anointing my feet. So at this point, I wonder how Simon is feeling. Jesus is not trying to humiliate him. He's just trying to get him to think through his actions, his heart, how he's been responding to Jesus, how we all respond to Jesus. And then we come to the third scene. We come to the third scene where, beginning at verse 47 through 50, is kind of the conclusion of this story, where Jesus is going to wrap things up, and he turns to the woman and he says, you see this woman, her sins are many. Go figure with that one, Simon. Her sins are many. You know that, Simon. You've already judged her. I wonder, in saying that, if Jesus was sort of subtly saying to Simon, Simon, she gets it about her life. She gets it. Do you get it about your life? How about your sins, Simon? I wonder if Jesus was kind of saying, you see this woman? You've already judged her, and her sins are many. And now, because she's loved much, she is forgiven. You know, that's a pivotal point in the story, and that's a theological point in the story where Jesus declares her forgiven. Why was she forgiven? I want you to think through this theologically. She's not forgiven because she cried. She's not forgiven because she anointed his feet with oil. She's not forgiven because she kissed his feet. She's forgiven because of verse 50, where Jesus said, your faith, a sincere faith, has saved you. And she's forgiven, secondly, because Jesus said, you're forgiven. Did you know that in the Bible? Before the cross, Jesus forgave people of their sin. It's all over the New Testament. When Jesus says you're forgiven, you're forgiven. When the precious Lamb of God says your sins are forgiven, you're forgiven. This was even before he died on the cross. So she's forgiven because of her faith. Verse 50, your faith has saved you. And she's forgiven because Jesus says she's forgiven. You know, that's an important point, and I wanted to emphasize that. And then the people around the table are going, wow. Not only was this an awkward moment that this woman weeps and cries at Jesus' feet, and Simon is kind of having to think through his lack of love, but then the crowd goes, or the people around the table are saying, who are you? Who are you that you forgive sins? They're all amazed. They're all astonished. So here's what we've got in the story. We've got expressive, emotive love. We've got a person, Simon, who's a great leader, who maybe doesn't know how to express his love very well and had to think through some things. We've got people who are astonished. And perhaps the better question is, you've been sitting now for about 15 minutes going, okay, relate this to my life. I know this is a good Bible story, relate it to my life. I was going to end with this, but I won't. I was going to end with either be like the woman or be like Simon. See yourself in both. But I'm not going to end that way. I'm going to talk about some implications for our life. What does it mean to love Jesus Christ? So I'm going to give you three or four implications from this wonderful story, wonderful account that only Luke records in the Bible. Number one, loving Jesus is heartfelt and passionate. If I can learn anything from this passage, that's going to be my main point. I want to be like this woman. Loving Jesus Christ is heartfelt and it's passionate. By saying that, I am not subtly criticizing the need to love the Lord with our mind or right doctrine or beliefs. In fact, next week I may preach on loving the Lord with our mind. What I am saying is this: a sincere faith in loving Jesus Christ is more than just a right belief or right doctrine or saying a creed in church. It's something about your heart and your emotions that says, I love you, Jesus. Some of you, now this is where it gets really serious. Some of you are really good at that, and some of you really suck at that. How's that for a good preacher? You're afraid of your own emotions. Learn something from this woman. I need to learn something from this woman who wasn't afraid to weep over her sin and say, I love you, Jesus. I honor you. I respect you. I call you my Lord. I call you my Savior. I don't know what that may be like in your life. Maybe there will be times in your life where you are just emotionally filled with being forgiven and healed by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Maybe there will be times where you're just so filled with God's love that it overwhelms you and you want to shout, you want to cry, then do that. Just not in the worship service. Amen. I mean, if I said do it, you won't. So I'm going to say don't do it, and you will. If anything, this woman is a wonderful example of loving the Lord with all of my heart, soul, and strength. Now, I am not saying, secondly, that you don't love Jesus Christ unless you're caught up in an emotional moment. That's not true either. I don't live on cloud nine all the time. I don't live in some extreme emotional moments all the time. Let me just give you a ridiculous example. Kind of broke my heart that both Montana State teams got beat in the first round of the NCAA. They are not in an emotional moment after losing both of their games. Both teams lost both games. But they still love the game of basketball. They still love the institution that they represent. So there are going to be times in all of our lives where we don't have wins. There are going to be times in our life where we feel about lower than a snake's belly. There are going to be times where you have grief. There are going to be times where you feel like, I don't know if I love the Lord. Yes, you do. All I'm saying is this. Loving Jesus. If you draw anything out of this story, loving Jesus is saying with my heart, with my emotions, I love you. And I will never cease loving you. I'm of the opinion if it doesn't touch your emotions, it may not touch your mind, even though I believe we love God with our mind. And maybe you're here today and you're going, you know, I don't understand what you're talking about, Ross. I don't understand. Ask the Lord to give you an emotional love for him. Ask the Lord to turn on the feelings. Ask the Lord to drop fire in your spirit, and he will. Because there's a fire in you. There's a fire in you that needs to be fanned into flame. Number two, implications. I put this in the form of a prayer. Let our actions be to you, Jesus. See, there's something about actions. The woman's actions and Simon's lack of actions that are messages in and of themselves. I draw this for my own life, and I hope for your life as well. Let my actions, whatever I do, be unto you, Jesus. Last week I talked about rediscovering our why. Why do we do anything? Why do we come to church? Why do we serve on a board? Why do we minister to people? Why do we do anything? I hope and pray that I connect anything that I do to, it's for you, Jesus. Colossians 3:23, let whatever your task, do it as unto the Lord and not to men. I don't want to do things because I'm paid to do it, because I get recognized, because it makes me feel good. I want to do things as unto Jesus. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 14. Let all that you do be done in love, not just love for people, love for him. I fail in that. I think we all do. Connecting all that we do, why we do what we do, as an expression of love for the Savior. It's kind of like that pastor, and I forgot his name, but I've used this story so often because it just touches my heart. He said he left his kitchen immaculate, spotless, clean, and he left it for about a half hour, and his five-year-old daughter came into the kitchen, and she made a mess. She put flour and butter and everywhere all over the counter, and he walked back in, but she had to leave for just a moment, but she left him a sticky note. Here was the kitchen in a mess. And she left him a little sticky note. And it said, I'm making something for you, Dad. I'm making something for you. And he said, his anger was just melted. When was the last time you had an encounter with Jesus where you're saying, I'm doing this for you, Jesus? I want our actions to be to you, Lord Jesus. Third implication is this. Be teachable about our love for him. I think for Simon and perhaps the others, as well as the woman, it was a very, very teachable moment about what it means to love Jesus Christ. Just the contrast. Simon, you gave me no kiss of greeting. You gave me no water for my feet. You never anointed my feet. You acted as if I wasn't even here, Simon. But she has not ceased to wash my feet with her tears and kiss my feet in honor and respect and praise. I put this on the screen. None of us have arrived in what it means to love Jesus. I don't think we have. Anybody here think you've arrived at what it means to love Jesus every day of your life? I certainly haven't. What does it mean to love him? I don't think any of us have arrived in that process. What it means to love him with all of my heart, soul, mind, and strength. I think sometimes we do. As long as we can come to church and just say a creed and know my theology and whatever that theology is, we think, I think I've arrived. I don't think there's any more in my life. I hope this is not anybody's opinion. But maybe sometimes in the back of our mind, we think we've arrived in what it means to love him. And teachable moments of what it means to love him. Let me just give you some examples of a teachable moment. Let's just kind of do a little bit of a deep dive on this one. Here's a teachable moment. I know that nobody here struggles with judging anybody else, right? Amen? Okay, I didn't think so. Especially people who wear t-shirts like this. Have you ever judged somebody else's sincerity or love for the Lord? And then you realize, why can I judge another person? I'm not sure I'm growing in my love for Jesus Christ. That's a teachable moment right there, where you become aware I'm judging somebody else's sincerity in their love for Jesus Christ. Here's another teachable moment. You've done something. Maybe you came to church. Maybe in the back of your mind you had a kind of a checklist mentality. I did that. I said my prayers. I read that chapter in the Bible. I did that. And you just sort of check it off. I must love the Lord. And you examine your motives and you're going, did I really do that out of love for you, Jesus? Or did I just do it because good Christians do that? And you're probably thinking right now, Pastor, would you get off of this? I came here to church to be inspired. I don't want to deep dive into my spirituality, and that's what I'm trying to do. Have you ever examined your motives? I pray that happens all the time. Not to wipe us out, but to say, what is the teachable moment in my life? Here's a third teachable moment. Have you ever been overwhelmed by God's love? You just been overwhelmed. God loves me. Jesus loves me, this I know. And you're overwhelmed by that. You're out driving your car. You're out for a walk. You're late at night, just overwhelmed by God's love. That's a teachable moment. That's a powerful moment. Pray for those moments. Oh, my word. You want those moments in your life. And they'll come. Ask for them. Those are teachable moments of responding out of love. So I know I've shared this before. I just want to give you a teachable moment that I've never forgotten. I was nearly 40 years old. I'm not 40 years old. This moment is about 40 years old. But it was a teachable moment for me. Oh, my word. I know I've shared it before, and it's been a while since I shared it. In the late 1980s, I went to a conference in Anaheim, and it was a Vineyard conference, and it was a wonderful conference. So it was more expressive worship, and on this Friday night, they opened it to the public. So there were more people at the conference at that Friday night service. That was the last point of the conference than normally. So the conference was probably 1,000 people, and there might have been 2,000 there that night. I mean, it's just open to public. So I got there late, and I sat behind a row of teenagers. Now, I'm not that old at the time. I'm not that old now. But I wasn't that old at the time. And I sat behind a row of teenagers. Never go to a conference in Southern California and sit behind a row of teenagers. It'll drive you nuts. And they were responding to the Lord. And they were jumping up and down. And they were shouting. And they were making me mad. And they were, I mean, I think I was pretty expressive, but I mean, they were just like on another planet. And they were so excited about their love for Jesus, and they're expressing their praise to God. And they were jumping up and down, and they were, and I was getting, I finally sat down and I said, and I've never forgotten this, Lord, Lord God, would you speak to them? Would you calm my nerves? Would you do something? Because I am really, this became my teachable moment. And the Lord, and if it was not an audible voice, it was pretty close to it. The Lord said to me, would you rather have them out dragging the gut and getting drunk? That shut my complaining up right now. I was Simon at that moment. Would I rather have these teenagers out dragging the gut and getting drunk? Here they were, in the house of the Lord on a Friday night, worshiping Jesus Christ. But no, they were upsetting me. And the Lord said, would you rather have them out dragging the gut and getting drunk? Thank you, Lord. That was a teachable moment. I ask you, what have been your teachable moments lately in your love for Jesus? Maybe it's you've been judging somebody. Maybe it's just you're overwhelmed with God's love. Maybe just the Lord speaks to you quietly about your own sincere desires about loving him. But make those teachable moments. Number four implication is this. Jesus gets you. Now, this is meant to be the encouraging word. This is, even though you feel like I kind of stepped on your toes, or I kind of challenged you in doing a deep dive about our love for Jesus Christ, this is the encouraging word. Jesus gets you. If I learn many implications from this story, I get this one. Jesus understood the woman. He understood her need for forgiveness. He also understood Simon and kind of Simon's shallow perspective. He loved him. He wasn't trying to humiliate him. He understood the people around the table who were going, "Who are you?" I just phrase it this way. Jesus gets you. Jesus gets me. Isn't it wonderful to be in a relationship with another human being who gets you, who understands you, and actually likes you? Right? Isn't it wonderful? Wouldn't it be great if everybody in the church just understood you and still likes you? go find that church, would you? Isn't it wonderful to be in a relationship with somebody who just gets you, understands you, and they still like you? That's our Jesus. That's why we love him. Let me just give you some examples. I don't know if he's still alive. I don't understand Arthur Blessett, who carried his cross across America and carried a cross to other continents. He literally carried a wooden cross. That was his ministry. I don't get that. I don't have to get him. Jesus gets him. That was his expression of love. Mother Teresa, who cared for lepers in Calcutta. I don't get that. What do you mean, Pastor, you don't get it? I struggle enough serving here in Billings, let alone lepers in Calcutta. I don't get that, but I don't need to get that. Jesus gets her. I don't get the people in the Upper Room movement in Dallas, Texas, who spend hours and hours and hours in worship and prayer And it's like when I look at them online, I go, doesn't anybody have a day job? I see young people in Dallas, Texas, in the Upper Room movement in Dallas, and they're just worshiping and worshiping and worshiping. I love to worship and worship and worship and pray. And I need to give myself more to that. But I don't get that. I don't need to get that. Jesus gets that. They're loving him. I'm trying to give you examples of Jesus gets you. You don't need to understand other people. Jesus gets your shallowness. Jesus gets your emotions. Jesus gets you and he loves you, and it's out of that love that you respond in love. In fact, I think that's the secret of loving him. He really loves you and he gets you, and he's going to put teachable moments in every one of our lives to trigger us to love him. He gets you. Maybe there's some of you today, you've come to church. I'm glad you're here and I'm glad you're online. You've never made a commitment to Jesus Christ. That's where it starts, but I've tried to gear this message to just really pouring your heart out in love for Jesus Christ. But it begins with a commitment. Some of you are here today, and perhaps you feel kind of the weight of the Holy Spirit going, oh, crap. I don't know, after listening to this message, if I really love Jesus. That's not my purpose. That's not the Lord speaking to you. That's guilt, condemnation, perhaps the devil. You love Jesus. You've given your life to him. But maybe some of you have never given your life to him, and you need to say, Jesus, I open my life to you. Maybe some of you feel like, I feel like I'm Simon. Okay, it's all right. Sometimes reading this passage, I do too. I feel like I'm Simon the Pharisee. I need to become more like this woman. And then as I was on my walk this morning, it just occurred to me, she made the Bible. She made the Bible. Not made it, she got in the Bible. Wow, that's cool. What she did that day got in to God's Word. I think that's pretty cool. Aren't you glad your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life? We need to rejoice at that. I want you to bow your head in prayer. Whatever you've taken from this message, let's put it at the feet of Jesus. Maybe there are some of you here today and you've never given your heart to Jesus Christ. You've never said, Lord, come into my life. I need forgiveness. My sins are many. I need forgiveness. And I commit my life to you. I need you in my life, Jesus, this morning. I need to come to you. I need to say, I love you, Lord. I call you my Savior and my Lord. And if that's just kind of out of your head today, that's all right. Just start there. Just start there. Say, Jesus, come into my life. If anything, you've taken anything from this message, maybe it's, Lord, make me. Help me to pour out my love for you. Don't just make my love an intellectual thing. Help me to pour out my love for you. Give me a new fire of love for you. Help me to weep in your presence. Help me to laugh in your presence. Help me to be overwhelmed with your love. Lord Jesus, we love you. We declare our love for you. Maybe there are some here, Lord, and I pray that you would just speak to their hearts and touch their hearts in a powerful way, that have never made a first step commitment to you. Let that begin today by just saying, Jesus, I need you in my life. Maybe there are some here, Jesus, I need to rededicate my life to you. I really have not been walking with you at all. Haven't been praying, haven't been reading my Bible, haven't been doing much of anything. Barely make it to church, and that's out of guilt. Just say, Jesus, overwhelm me with your love. Just draw me back to your love. Maybe you've been doing the whole checklist thing, and you just need to say, Lord, I love you. I fail at my checklist. I fail living up to my Lenten goals, but I love you. Maybe just say that in your spirit this morning. Forgive us, Lord, for judging somebody else's love for you. Somebody who appears to be more like a Simon to us, or somebody who appears to be like this woman. We just want to be like you, Jesus. Help us to do that. Overwhelm us with your love. Thank you for forgiving us of our sin. Thank you that spiritually, metaphorically, symbolically, we will weep at your feet. Perhaps literally we'll weep at your feet. We'll kiss your feet. We'll anoint your feet with oil, with our praise, with our love. Thank you for the privilege of the desire to want to do that. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that we're going to wear our love for you on our shirt sleeve. Let it show in our life, Lord. Forgive us of the sin of playing church, our unbelief. We're glad we're here. Thank you that, just thank you for your precious love. Would you melt every heart, including mine? Just melt our hearts, Lord, in your love. But it isn't just about coming to this building. It's about every day loving you. Help us to do that, Lord. Thank you for getting us, understanding us in what we do and our expressions of love to you. In your precious name, Lord, amen. Let's stand as we sing, I love you, Lord. Yes, go in the grace and the love of the Father over your life. If any of you want prayer, I'd be glad to pray with you before you leave today.